Well, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome back. Hope you had a great lunch. I must say, I certainly found it interesting, and what I particularly enjoyed was not the food so much, but the feedback. next time we'll do this in Europe and the food will be better, but I did appreciate the feedback, and I'd really encourage you to keep giving it to us, you know, throughout the day. It's very useful as we, you know, as we think through the issues and the impressions that you're getting. So I'm Richard Nodder. I'm CEO of Goldman Sachs International, and in that capacity, I'm responsible for all of our businesses outside of North America. I joined Goldman Sachs 33 years ago in London, in Europe, as we started to build out our M&A business across that continent. 10 years later, I went to Japan, then to Singapore, and then on to Hong Kong. When sitting in Hong Kong, I was responsible for our Asian business. I returned to London in 2005 and assumed a number of regional and global leadership roles until taking on my current responsibilities. So I've really had the privilege to work across the world and to be involved in building out many of our international businesses. And so it really gives me great pleasure to discuss the importance of this international footprint to the firm and to run through some of the strategic and commercial advantages that it gives to the firm. You know, simply put, complexity is a constant for our global client base. Today it comes from nationalism, trade, other issues. Tomorrow there'll be something else. And as both David and John observed in their comments this morning, it is really this global footprint that the firm has that allows us to help our clients navigate the challenges that they face, whatever those challenges may be, and wherever they may be. And so I want to leave you with a few key takeaways. First, Goldman Sachs' international growth really proves the firm's capacity to grow organically, patiently, over time, and to build businesses of very significant scale, and to do so profitably. Second, we have ambition to grow further, both by growing with our existing clients and by taking on new clients, by growing share. Third, there are a number of very significant breakout opportunities that we focused on. Some of them are geographic, others within our existing business portfolios, scaling alternatives, scaling our international private wealth business. And finally, I believe we can do all of this whilst at the same time driving further efficiencies. So let's start with some very quick history. The journey began 50 years ago. In fact, in January, so this month, 50 years ago, we opened our first office in London, followed shortly by an office opening in Japan. These were really the foundation years for our international business. We moved senior leaders across the world. We hired local teams. Importantly, we embedded our culture into these teams. We started to build client relationships. But it takes time. As you can see from the slide, by 1990, our international operations were still a relatively small part of the overall organization. But roll the clock forward 30 years, a very, very different position. Goldman Sachs present in all the key global economic hubs, as you can see on the slide. Revenues up over 20-fold to $15 billion. 12 times the number of people, 5 times the number of offices. Strong, diverse teams representing local and global capabilities everywhere. So this picture has taken us 5 decades to build. It's not been easy. It takes sustained commitment and determination. You can't just switch it on and off. Many have tried and failed. So this deep international footprint has brought real balance to the firm, and it has done so in scale, as the previous slide demonstrated. Over 40% of the firm's revenues come from outside of North America, and at a margin of 28% pre-tax. And this includes a 5 percentage point impact due to litigation. And so investing in this global footprint has been accretive to the overall firm. The strength of this global and local mix is well illustrated on the far side of this slide. A truly diverse and global team with over 140 different nationalities represented. The leadership group is equally broad and diverse, representing the makeup of our client base. 42% of the firm's partner and managing director group sit outside of North America. An average tenure of 13 and a half years, so significant experience, representing 80 different nationalities. And so across this portfolio of businesses, we as a firm have the leading geographic reach and share. So that's from the client's perspective. Importantly, what is the so what for our clients? Simply put, it enables One Goldman Sachs to solve client challenges anywhere and everywhere. I'll talk to you about two examples. The first is a local company in need of global expertise and global capital. I'll focus on Dong Energy, going back to 2013 in Copenhagen, Denmark. You had a private, state-owned energy company, a heavy carbon footprint, in need of a strategy that would transform its future and take it down a green path. Our private equity teams, alongside our infrastructure investing group, working with our investment bankers, developed such a strategy. We put in place a new management team, a new board, and working with those groups, executed on the plan. At the invitation of the Danish state, which at that time was not in a position to invest its own capital, we mobilized our global capital and put it alongside two local Danish pension funds. The result? Ørsted. Today, the largest offshore wind company in the world, a 3x growth in market cap since its initial listing, a continued large holding in the company by the government. So a rewarding investment for the government, but also ourselves and our clients. And to this day, this remains an important financing and advisory client. The second example is a company with broad global ambition, looking for our local capabilities everywhere to help support this growth. CK Hutchison out of Hong Kong. As they have expanded globally, they've been able to rely on Goldman Sachs to acquire telecom assets in many jurisdictions across Europe and Asia Pacific, to grow their global energy business and their retail business, to issue debt and equity to fund this growth distributed through our global securities businesses, and finally, at the center, our team in Hong Kong restructuring the entire group to deliver the structure that they have today. So the expertise that I highlight in these two examples is sought out by clients everywhere. Consider that on the investment banking front, 39% of our M&A volumes of the last 5 years have had a cross-border dimension to them. Or in our global markets business, 20% of our global client activity is executed outside of the client's home region. And so the result of this franchise and this footprint, leading market shares. Now, being global and being the leader globally requires consistent leading market shares across the world. We have the leading investment banking franchise. Greg Lemkow went through that this morning. He also reviewed the way that we think about market share. And as you look at this slide, you can see on the M&A, starting at the top of the slide, number one. But as you go from left to right, our market shares actually weaken. We're number one in Europe, number one in Asia Pacific. More recently, going into Latin America, we've got more work to do. So as you dig further, there's more opportunity. And I could make the same comments as I go down the slide. And clearly, when you get to the bottom of the slide, there are a number of businesses there where we've got significant market share potential. But we know where the gaps are, and we're working to fill them. I'll give you an example in the global markets business on the equity side. Go back 3 years, Eurostock 600, a market share of 8%. The MiFID II regulations come along, consolidation. We invested very significantly in our execution capabilities. Today, our market share, 15%, a growth of 1.9 times over that period. So we know where the gaps are. We're working to fill them. So what of the forward? The important point is we have one consistent global strategy. On the left-hand side of the slide, you can see that we're expanding our corporate coverage. The investment bank is picking up new clients across our European footprint, and they're doing so in the size range of 500 million to 2 billion, as Greg discussed this morning. We've added over 500 companies in that size. We've in fact increased the overall footprint by 800. And to date, that expansion has delivered 170 new mandates, helping drive revenue growth. We also continue to grow and deepen our footprint in new geographies. Just last month, we launched our onshore FIC business in South Africa, giving us access to corporate clients and to local bond flows. Last year, we launched our onshore equity business in Saudi Arabia ahead of its inclusion in the MSCI and the FTSE EM benchmark. Turning to an example of diversifying our business mix with new products and services internationally is the middle of the slide. And I'll just highlight the success of Marcus UK. This is a story that is not yet 18 months old. $7.6 billion of deposits raised, 400,000 new accounts. And so success in this crowded market highlights the strength of our brand away from the US and the competitiveness of the product that we launched. Coming to the right-hand side of the slide, let's talk about efficiency. John Waldron focused on this morning, but those messages apply across the world. We have over 5,000 people in Bengaluru. We've also got scale in Singapore and Warsaw. All the firm's divisions across all time zones are supported from these centers. They also provide leadership as we drive digital transformation and process automation initiatives around the world. I will now talk to you about some key regional opportunities that we see. Let's start with Europe. The UK is already a very significant contributor to the firm, and we have significant market shares there. Let's turn to continental Europe, the second largest economy in the world. Given the weak growth and the other macro headlines that you read about Europe, you may be forgiven for thinking that this business is a laggard. Far from it. It has some noteworthy trends that are creating real opportunity for the firm. EU bank balance sheets continue to be under pressure, leading to growth in capital markets activity. Competitors are repositioning their businesses, giving us room to grow share. Negative rates are creating challenges, creating significant opportunity for our structuring and investing and advising businesses. And finally, Europe's leaders' push to complete banking and capital markets union will over time create significant further growth for the organization. And so we're investing in our footprint to capitalize on these opportunities. Over the last 3 years, we've increased our EU 27 headcount by around 70%. That's away from our investment in Warsaw. And it compares with a 13% increase in our overall European headcount. So let's go east and talk about Japan. We are one of the leading foreign banks in Japan. We have a strong and stable business there. We benefit from tenured leadership across all of our businesses. And given the existence of developed capital markets, there's been the opportunity to scale a significant business, and we have done so. We've also built one of the leading investment banking businesses in the marketplace. Through our merchant banking teams, we've been an active investor for a long period of time. Over the last 25 years, we've put $6 billion to work in that marketplace, and that's yielded a $7 billion return to the benefit of our clients and to the firm. So taken together, this is a strong franchise and a very significant contributor to the firm. And in fact, if you had to rank the contribution by country across the organization, over the last 5 years, Japan would rank 3. So very important in terms of providing diversification to our business. Let's talk about China. Clearly a market with a very significant future potential in terms of growth. We've been onshore in China for over 25 years, and over that period, we've been the number one foreign bank ranked in terms of M&A activity and equity underwriting. Through this period, we've invested $10 billion and driven $15 billion in value creation. And we continue to see immense opportunities in a shifting landscape. By the mid-2020s, our Goldman Sachs research teams believe that there will be a revenue pool in excess of $100 billion across our portfolio of businesses. We're well positioned to participate in this growth across all of our businesses. We have a differentiated position given our long-term participation in the marketplace. We are very active in the early privatization wave, really leading that wave across a number of different industries, telecom, energy, financials. We've got strong relationships with many of the country's leading private sector companies and have been investing heavily in terms of building relationships with the new emerging private sector in that country. We've also sought to partner with China's leadership from a policy perspective, providing thought leadership as they seek to build a financial system that's fit for purpose and can help fund the enormous growth that economy is enjoying. As John said earlier, we plan to secure 100% ownership of our onshore joint venture. But importantly, when we established that joint venture in 2004, we did it in a way that gave us effective management control. And so since that period of time, we've been able to build a Goldman Sachs standard team fully integrated into our global network. And so when we secure 100% ownership, we will have a team that's already fully integrated, up and running, and that should give us an advantage and a head start over many of our competitors. We will continue to invest significantly across all our businesses in this growing market. Let me now highlight two business lines where we think there's significant market share potential. First, our alternatives investing business. Before diving into the slide, I want to highlight again an example of one Goldman Sachs at work. As we've laid out our footprint in many new markets, we've had a significant advantage by putting our investment bankers alongside our merchant banking investing professionals, really a traditional merchant banking approach. First of all, by putting our own capital to work, we've been able to signal real long-term commitment to the marketplace. Second, by these teams working together, we've been able to bring the full suite of financing alternatives to bear for the benefit of our client base. It has helped accelerate our growth. So turning to the slide, on fundraising, you can see that over 50% of third-party capital raised for global strategies is raised outside of the US. On the investing side, we have a team of over 400 investing professionals spread across 18 different countries. $110 billion of alternative assets invested internationally, with over $20 billion invested in developing markets, a well-diversified portfolio. This gives us strong confidence in our ability to grow this business. The investing team is in place. It is local. It understands local market nuances. This gives us a clear edge. We've got strong international fundraising capabilities. We have a unique sourcing engine given the strength of our investment banking footprint. And we have a track record of delivering strong returns as Julian and Tim went through earlier this morning. And all of this at a time when there's robust demand for this asset class. So turning to this slide, it highlights the breadth and depth of the platform by asset class and geography. The dots show the geographic spread and selected investments on the right. I won't go through them all, but I could highlight many successes, from Taikan Insurance Group in China to the IQ student accommodation platform in the UK, from the Nexi payments platform in Italy to Japan Renewable Energy in Japan, IHS, the towers business in Nigeria, to building out oncology centers in Brazil. The fact is, by asset class, by geography, by industry, we have deep and proven experience. So it's a platform that is uniquely positioned to offer attractive investment opportunities for both institutional and private client investors. And I'm going to come back to the private client point in a second. But in short, this international track record gives us significant confidence in our ability to meet our $100 billion fundraising target. So let's turn to international private wealth. Given our starting point, the growth opportunity for us is self-evident. If you look at this slide and you compare our 1% market share in the international business with a 7% in the US, the upside is there. If we grow that international share by 1%, it'll yield an incremental $170 billion of client assets. This exceeds the size of our current business. So why grow now? First, the competitive playing field has been leveled. We deselected ourselves from large parts of the wallet as standards were too low in areas such as tax transparency, money laundering, and the like. That situation has changed, standards have been raised, and so we can now compete. Second, we've spent the last few years re-engineering our footprint. International and US margins are now aligned, and our business has demonstrated an ability to grow. In 2019, we delivered record revenues, profitability, and client assets. We have over 200 advisors, $150 billion of international client assets. The business model is proven and positioned to scale further. Finally, and this is a very important point, our client offering is distinctive. Consider yourself a private client of the firm. You have access to our advisors. You have access to the number one investment banking footprint, the advice they can bring, the structuring advice they can bring. You have access to the insights and the liquidity that comes from our global markets business, and importantly, to the proprietary alternative investment offering that I've just discussed. And I go back to Eric's presentation of earlier this morning. For the first time, we have a true lending capability in the international arena, very important for this client base. So with that as background, we plan to increase our number of advisors by 50% across both Europe and Asia in the coming years. So let me conclude where I began. The international business is significant and it is profitable, 40% of the firm's revenues. We have a proven ability to grow over the decades, and we see significant growth ahead across all of our businesses. I focused on two significant geographic opportunities, China and the EU 27, a number of specific business lines, alternatives and private wealth. And very importantly, we believe we can do all of this in a way that is accretive to the overall profitability of the firm. And so with that, it gives me great pleasure to welcome two of my partners to the stage, Stephanie Cohen and Marco Argenti, who are going to talk about innovation. Thank you.